namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. So we are in chapter one. We've started the Gita again. We went through the introduction already, and now we're on the first chapter, which is called Observing the Army on the Battlefield of Kurukshetra. And this chapter I really like a lot. When I first started reading the Gita, I didn't understand it at all. I was like, you know, why are they having a war? This is supposed to be a holy book. This is like the Bible. Why are they fighting right at the start? I didn't even know who the characters were or what was going on, you know. And people have asked me, why does it start with a battle? What's going on? So now we all know why it's going on and what Krishna is planning to do here. And so if we remember, I don't know if any of you have been, you've been to Mother Yashoda Mayi's classes. So I don't know how many have been, but she always did a thorough analysis of each chapter so we could understand it. So in this chapter, did anybody go to her classes? Is anybody here who been to her classes?
She used to come early. Now, these days she's not coming.
No, she's not coming. But she gave us so. Yeah, she at the end of every chapter, she gave a complete analysis of what was happening so we could easily understand it. So in this chapter, what's being covered, the subjects are. Put them down somewhere, is the, if I remember, it's this, the sound of the victories, and, okay, I'm not going to speculate if I don't have it here, because there are certain things that are happening here. Krishna as Bhaktivatsal, and Arjuna's doubts, that's the last subtitle. So I'm trying to remember the first two. It's the sounds of victory. I know that was one. Okay, I thought I wrote it down here. Even myself, I can't remember. So anyway, these are the subjects that are being covered in this chapter. And so we see what's happening here is Arjuna has asked Krishna. Krishna is his chariot driver. So Arjuna has asked Krishna, can you please take me out in front of the battlefield in the middle, excuse me, of the two armies so I can see who I'm about to fight. So Arjuna wanted to see who was arrayed out there. He knew it was his family, but he just wanted to see how, you know, they were all just, you know, wanting to do this battle. And actually being led by Duryodhana, because Dhritarashtra, his father, you know, was weak in terms of his spiritual vision as well as his material vision. So he let Duryodhana run everything, and he mostly supported him, you know, in his desires, you know, to lord it over everyone. So they were all arrayed out there on the battlefield, and Arjuna wanted to go out there and look around, and he was starting to have some, you know, doubts about why am I fighting with my relatives? Actually, I heard someone say in a class a couple of days ago, they said, like, okay, there's two ways to interpret this relative. Relative means, like, relative to the absolute. So his relatives were just relative to what he wanted, but actually, they were relative to what the absolute wanted. So he was feeling, you know, like, I don't think I want to do this. Okay, so we'll start reading. I'll read the four verses, and then everyone can read, but each person takes, you know, the next one coming, and we can just keep repeating it until we go through the whole, all the verses. Is that understandable, what I said? One person starts with Kimno Rajena, and then the next person does the next verse, and the next person does the next verse, and then
one will recite one.
Thank you. Yes. Okay. Kimno Rajena Govinda. Kimbo Gajavititinava. Yes, Amada Kung Shitamno. Rajamboga Sukanita. Taime Vastita Yudhe. Pranam Twakva Dananicha. Acharya Pitara Putras. Tataiva Chapitamaha. Matula Swasrua Pautra. Shala Sambandinastata. Etana Hatumichami. Jantopi Madhusudana. Apitrayaloke Rajasya. Heto kem nu mahi krite. Nihadya jadarastranaha. Ka pritri sajjanardana. Okay. Start. Somebody read. Start reading, please. Okay, word for word. Kim, what use? Na, to us. Rajena. Is the kingdom. Govindam. O Krishna. Kim. What? Bogai. Enjoyment. Jivitena. Living. Va. Either. Yesam. Of whom? Ate. For the sake. Kankshitam. Is desired. Na. By us. Rajam. Kingdom. Boga, material enjoyment. Sukhani, all happiness. Cha, also. Te, all of them. Ime, these. Avastitaha, situated. Yude, on this battlefield. Panan, lives. Twaktava, giving up. Danani, riches. Cha, also. Acharya, teachers. Pitara, fathers. Putra, sons. Tata, as well as. Eva, certainly. Cha, also. Pitamaha, grandfathers. Matula, maternal uncles. Swasura, fathers-in-law. Pautra, grandsons. Shala, brothers-in-law. Sambandina, relatives. Tata, as well as. Etan, all these. Na, never. Hantum, to kill. Ichami, do I wish? Nataha, being killed. Api, even. Madhusudana, oh, killer of the demon Madhu, Krishna. Api, even if. Trailokya, of the three worlds. Rajasya, for the kingdom. Hetaho, in exchange. Kim nu, what to speak of? Mahikute, for the sake of the earth. Nihatya, by killing. Dhritarashtran, the sons of Dhritarashtra. Naha, our. Ka, what? Pritihi, pleasure. Shat, will there be? Janardana.
Janardana.
O maintainer of all living entities. Translations and purports by His very divine grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Srila Prabhupada. O Govinda, of what avail to us our kingdom, happiness, or even life itself, when all those for whom we may desire them are now arrayed on this battlefield? O Madhusudana, when teachers, fathers, sons, grandfathers, maternal uncles, fathers-in-law, grandsons, brothers-in-law, and other relatives are ready to give up their lives and properties and are standing before me, why should I wish to kill them, even though they might otherwise kill me? O maintainer of all living entities, I am not prepared to fight with them even in exchange for the three worlds, let alone this earth. What pleasure will we derive from killing the sons of Dhritarashtra? So repeat, O Govinda, of what avail to us our kingdom, happiness, or even life itself, when all those for whom we may desire them are now arrayed on this battlefield. O Madhusudana, when teachers, fathers, sons, grandfathers, maternal uncles, fathers-in-law, grandsons, brothers-in-law, and other relatives are ready to give up their lives and properties and are standing before me, why should I wish to kill them, even though they might otherwise kill me? O maintainer of all living entities, I'm not prepared to fight with them, even in exchange for the three worlds, let alone this earth. What pleasure will we derive from killing the sons of Dhritarashtra? So that's pretty intense. He's named all the his whole dynasty just about is arrayed on the battlefield, ready to fight over the land and the property, which is what the roadrunner is coveting. This is what he wants. Purport. Arjuna has addressed Lord Krishna as Govinda because Krishna is the object of all pleasures for cows and the senses. By using this significant word, Arjuna indicates that Krishna should understand what will satisfy Arjuna's senses. But Govinda is not meant for satisfying our senses. If we try to satisfy the senses of Govinda, however, then automatically our own senses are satisfied. Materially, everyone wants to satisfy his senses, and he wants God to be the order supplier for such satisfaction. The Lord will satisfy the senses of the living entity as much as they deserve, but not to the extent that they may covet. But when one takes the opposite way, namely, when one tries to satisfy the senses of Govinda without desiring to satisfy one's own senses, then by the grace of Govinda, all desires of the living entity are satisfied. Arjuna's deep affection for community and family members is exhibited here partly due to his natural compassion for them. He is therefore not prepared to fight. Everyone wants to show his opulence to friends and relatives, but Arjuna fears that all his relatives and friends will be killed on the battlefield and he will be unable to share his opulence after victory. This is a typical calculation of material life. The transcendental life, however, is different. Since a devotee wants to satisfy the desires of the Lord, he can, Lord willing, accept all kinds of opulence for the service of the Lord. And if the Lord is not willing, he should not accept a farthing. Arjuna did not want to kill his relatives. And if there were any need to kill them, he desired that Krishna kill them personally. At this point, He did not know that Krishna had already killed them before their coming into the battlefield, and that he was only to become an instrument for Krishna. This fact is disclosed in following chapters. As a natural devotee of the Lord, Arjuna did not like to retaliate against his miscreant cousins and brothers, but it was the Lord's plan that they should all be killed. The devotee of the Lord does not retaliate against the wrongdoer, but the Lord does not tolerate any mischief done to the devotees by the miscreants. The Lord can excuse a person on his own account, but he excuses no one who has done harm to his devotees. Therefore, the Lord was determined to kill the miscreants, although Arjuna wanted to excuse them. Here's what I was looking for. This chapter. What's in this chapter is preparations for war. This is just the synopsis of the whole chapter. Signs of victory. Krishna is Bhakta Vatsal. And the last is Arjuna's doubts. First, I'd like to throw out some questions and get some feedback, get some interaction going between us, since we're all here, you know, to relish this topic and to relish this chapter. So why is Krishna on the battlefield with the Pandavas? Why is he supporting this? This is, in the material world, this is called a parricide. It's when, it's in this material world, it's a crime to kill, you know, one's mothers, fathers, and other relatives. But this is on a whole different level. So let's have some discussion about what is Krishna doing and why is he supporting this killing? Can I raise some hands and have some discussion about this? Anyone? Yes. And also, we know in 4:7, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutanam adharmasya tadatmanam sajyamyaham. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharata, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. And then the following one is 4:8, which is Paritranaya Sarunam. Everybody knows this one, right? Vinasaya Chaduskritam. You can repeat it with me. Dharmasya Samasta Parnataya Sam Bhavame Yuge Yuge. So to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to reestablish the principles of religion, I myself appear millennium after millennium. So as is said in this purport, Krishna has already planned it. They're already done. They're already eliminated as far as Krishna is concerned. But his purposes in engaging in Arjuna, we know Arjuna is a pure devotee, so we can, you know, like imbibe that fact. But in this Gita, what are the reasons that Krishna is engaging Arjuna in all of this? We read about it all the time. Yes. Anyone?
Through Arjuna, Krishna wants to exhibit how one should be, people in the material life, should leave the day-to-day problems. So, in this whole chapter, Krishna has guided Arjuna after raising his lot of questions, why not to fight. Then Krishna wants to explain the things to us through Arjuna.
Yes.
Krishna wants to explain the things to us through Arjuna, that how we can handle our day-to-day problems, day-to-day life problem. That is the biggest problem which Arjuna is facing, to kill his own relatives. And we have to take the decisions on daily basis, whether to do this, whether to do this or not do this. What is wrong and what is not wrong is not the point. Point is that what should be in the interest of the Lord. That things we should supposed to do.
Okay.
These are the things what Krishna is trying to.
Okay. And what else? There's others. You're right, and there's others as well. Anybody else? No? Because we read in the Gita that they have a very deep friendship. He's his dear friend, and he's not envious. Arjuna is not envious. And Krishna wants to it says that this Gita was lost, this information was lost, because it was being passed down, but it got lost somewhere in between. So Krishna wanted to reinitiate this pampara, handing down these messages for the entire civilization. So he picked Arjuna because they were close friends. Arjuna wasn't envious, you know. So that's why he also, you know, like engaged Arjuna in this. Okay, and he was trying to bring Arjuna to the point of letting go of his conceptions about what will please him, what will please Arjuna. You know, he was trying to educate him as to what is the real priority. Okay, so Arjuna, he's kind of in a conflict. You know, he's doubtful. He's representing the living entities, and we all have conflicts every day. There are things that we have to deal with. And how do we solve them? We solve them with guru, sadhu, and sastra. We're devotees, so we know we can't speculate about what should be done and what should not be done. Everything's spelled out, you know, in our scriptures about what should be done and what should not be done. And if we're also having a spiritual master, we know, you know, that we just ask, you know, should I do this or should I not do this? We shouldn't speculate. But Arjuna is in representing the living entities. He's considering his own selfish desires, what will please him, you know, because in this purport, Prabhupada says, Arjuna's deep affection for community and family members is exhibited here partly. He didn't say his deep affection for community and family members is exhibited here due to his natural compassion. He said partly, that word partly in there. So it's not everything, you know. So Arjuna wanted to please his own senses, and he wanted Krishna to please his senses. So we know that's not for us as devotees, as Prabhupada says later in this purport, that we are here to please Krishna's senses. And I was reading in Gita 1:15, just some little note here, that Krishna is called Hrishikesh, which means that he's the owner of all the senses. And as living, we're all his parts and parcels. All the entities in the whole world are part of Krishna. We're all his parts and parcels. So that means that if we serve him, then our senses are automatically satisfied. We've talked about this before, that we automatically become happy if we feel Krishna is satisfied. So he's, in 327, it says he's the master of the senses of the material bodies. And I found another interesting thing here, which, you know, is really nice to hear, is Hrishikesh. And his other name is Keshi Nisudana, which means that he is the master of all the senses, but he's also the one who can help us attain material serenity. I'm sorry, I didn't mean material. We don't want to go there. Mental serenity. You know, we're all looking for peace. So the only way we can find peace is to surrender into Krishna and follow his instructions, serve the spiritual master and serve the devotees. And we can see that Krishna, as we move further into the chapter, into the Gita, particularly also into chapter 2, Krishna uses some pretty strong words in terms of talking about Arjuna's lamentation. Why is he lamenting? You know, so he calls him a fool, and we're also supposed to look like a fool in front of our spiritual master. We should. And also, he's using very strong language against Arjuna's, you know, wanting not to fight, to give up his dharma as a kshatriya, you know, and go to the forest. And as a kshatriya, he has to have a kingdom. He has to have something to rule. That's his dharma. He's not going to be happy in the forest. But he thinks he'll be happy if he gives everything up. So the Krishna says, calls him like you're a fool, you're impotent, you're having a petty weakness of heart. What is all of this? I didn't expect this from you. No. So he wanted him to, you know, to snap out of his lamentation. So the compassion can be there, but also Krishna is showing compassion to Arjuna by helping him understand his duty, what he's supposed to do, and serve him. And he won't accrue any sinful reactions because Krishna is the one who's, he's following Krishna's lead. Krishna is the one who's directing him. We have to follow Krishna. Actually, I was just thinking about, you know, there's so much turmoil in the world right now. And people are demonstrating and getting upset about mandates and this and that. In fact, you know, there's even, you know, a little bit of division amongst the devotees about mandates and vaccinations. But in the material world, they're all trying to fight. But what will they gain if their movements are not being dictated by obedience to the Lord's order? What's going to come out of it? You know, if you're not following, you know, the scripture, if you're not following Krishna, if you're not following God, then this world will just keep on going just like that. There'll be something else that'll happen, you know, because they're not following, you know, what Krishna has dictated for us to do, following the scriptures. That's why he wrote this. I mean, also in the scriptures, in the Vedic literatures, he, you know, to bring those persons who are not ready yet, who are at different stages of consciousness, at least if you just follow his instructions, you know, how to maintain yourself, you know, to reach the point of love of God, to reach that point. Because if you're following the scriptures, then you're going on the right path. So everyone, you know, as it says here, wants to show their opulence off, you know, and share it with family and friends. This is, we'll talk a little bit about the character of Duryodhana, because he kind of we call a prototype of a materialist, you know. So his character is he's a game player, and he doesn't play by any, you know, he uses evil means to get what he wants. He has no concern for anyone else's happiness but his own. And actually, I'm not gonna read all of the next one, that'll be for the next person, but in the next purport, there are reasons, and all of these reasons were committed against the Pandavas. So it says here, according to Vedic instruction, there are six kinds of aggressors. A poison giver, one who sets fire to the house. So we know early on that Drona and Dushasan and his friends, they gave a poison cake to Bhima. So, and then one who sets fire to the house. So we know about the House of Lack, where Drona got coerced his father to agree that the Pandavas go to Varnavat and live in this house, and everything had been planned that it was supposed to be burned down while they were in it. So he tried to kill them all. And then one who attacks with deadly weapons, you know, so that's there as well. And one who plunders riches. Because Drona was in charge of the treasury, and he was spending as much as he could. He was trying to clean out the treasury by spending all the money, you know, trying to make them broke. That's why he was so upset when they went to, when they built up Indraprastha and they had so much opulence. He was so green with envy. He could hardly contain himself. He was just very green with envy because he thought he had defeated them by giving them that barren land. The problem with Drona was that as a materialist, when he went to see Krishna in Dwarka, along with Arjuna, who came later, we've been hearing this, and it's nice to hear. It's a reminder that we should always bow down to the Lord as many times as we can, you know, because it keeps us humble and keeps us remembering who we are in comparison to the Lord, and who should be worshipped, and who should be honored. So so he was very, very envious when he saw that palace. And, okay, and then one who occupies another's land and one who kidnaps a wife. So we know what happened with Draupadi, and also that Jayadrath also tried to kidnap Draupadi. So all the insults were there. So for these reasons, they should be killed, actually. It's okay. A satriya can kill them for committing these offenses against the Pandavas. So the character of Drona, you know, he puts pleasures above principles. You know, for him, I want to enjoy, and I don't care who suffers. I want all the money, I want all the wealth, I want whatever I can get, and I'll get it by any means possible. And we see that goes on here. And actually, I was thinking, like, when I used to work some long time ago, years ago, I used to work in an insurance company. And I was kind of shocked when I looked at all the cases were coming in to find out that people actually tried to kill their relatives to get the money. This is the type of world we're living in. You know, that they would actually concoct all kind of ways to kill their relatives just so they can get the money. So I was, you know, kind of a little bit, you know, like disturbed by that. I was like, wow, we're living in a world that is not nice, and we shouldn't want to linger here and think we can enjoy. The only way we can enjoy is if Krishna enjoys, if we surrender to Krishna, then, you know, everything's okay. And then he relies on his own power to strategize. I was in the middle of saying that when Drona went there, and Krishna woke up and he saw Arjuna first, because Arjuna was standing at his feet. But Drona was standing at his head. He doesn't know you're supposed to stand at the Lord's feet, you know. He wants everybody to stand at his feet. So Krishna asked Arjuna, what did he want? You know, and Arjuna said, Krishna, I just want you. And then Drona was ecstatic. He was like, yes. That's all I want to know, because he, you know, asked for the army. And it was a very powerful army. So this, he's thinking materially that I have, now I have 11 Akshohini of you know, of army. So there's no chance for me to lose. He was figuring everything out on his own power. He thought he had everything figured out. I'll do this, I'll do that, then I'll get this and I'll get that. And I can step on somebody, I can kill somebody, I can do whatever. But I'm going to win, is his mentality. Forgetting the Krishna factor, you know. And I just wanted to read from, I bought one Srimad Bhagavatam, 1:16:34. It says here, so this is Dharana's mentality. And it's the mentality of the materialist who just want sense gratification. The asuras want to enjoy a life of sense gratification, even at the cost of others' happiness. In order to fulfill his ambition, the asuras, especially atheistic kings or state executive heads, try to equip themselves with all kinds of deadly weapons to bring about a war in a peaceful society. They have no ambition other than personal aggrandizement. So personal aggrandizement means they just want to be recognized as the best, the most powerful, the one who has all the money, the one who can make you or break you. That's what they want. That's power to them. And we see that happening now in the material world. The fights among the politicians, the fights between the citizens and the politicians, the citizens' fights for trying to get their rights. It's just a battlefield. And none of them are bowing down to the Lord. And thus Mother Earth feels overburdened by such undue increases of military strength. So this is what Krishna was trying to eradicate, this military strength, this demoniac military strength that was represented by those soldiers, those kings on the battlefield, because they were all very, very powerful kings. By the increase of the Asuric population, those who follow the principles of religion become unhappy, especially the devotees or devas. So this government, the government's now even shutting down the churches. They don't want the people to even worship. You know, don't go looking to God, you know, for anything. This is what's happening. They're just crushing the spirit of the innocent praja that they're supposed to be taking care of, just so they can fill their coffers. Because even in this pandemic, the people who have the money are getting richer and richer, just from the suffering of the people. They're just gathering the coffers, filling up the coffers with the sufferings of the general population, people who can't see their relatives, or people who are suffering due to the pandemic for the last 2 years. But those other people are filling up their coffers, and they're becoming more money than they can even do spend in two lifetimes, never mind one. No. So it says here, in such a situation, the personality of Godhead incarnates to vanquish the unwanted asuras and to reestablish the true principles of religion. This was the mission of Lord Sri Krishna, and he fulfilled it. So Dharana was just thinking, and he's representative of the materialistic thinking. He's depending on his own strength to get things done based on his own, like, material talents, his connections. Whose favor can he, you know, who can give him certain favors, you know, and whose assets can he take or borrow or beg or steal? So all of these are exhibited in the world that we're living in. People are depending on science. They'll do science and then overcome all the problems of life and then crush any opposition. So the whole world is living in a dream. They're thinking that their wholesale material pursuits, you know, are going to make them happy. They're all going to be happy. And that, but this dream that they have regularly gets punctured like a balloon, you know. In, of course, we read in the 16th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita the characteristics of the demoniac, the mentality. And they think that just to gratify their senses is a prime necessity of human civilization. And they're attracted by the impermanent pleasures. And in 13 to 15, if you read the verses, it says, so much wealth do I have, and I'll gain more according to my schemes. So this is the mentality. And so Krishna is trying to help Arjuna work through his thinking and feeling. He wants him to do his duty. You know, and actually, Krishna consciousness is not a sentimental process. It's a scientific process. We just have to follow it and see the results. You know, because feelings change all the time. We're always changing how we feel about something. So if we do our service as a matter of duty, then there's no, you know, room for, well, I don't feel like doing it today. No. It's not a sentimental process. And the emotions we feel towards the devotees and towards Krishna is all very transcendental. It has nothing to do with mundane material feelings. And so in this transcendental life, the devotees want to satisfy Krishna's desires. And the devotee who wants to satisfy Krishna's desires can accept all opulences. We see, Prabhupada came to America with, what, 40 rupees? I don't think he could even change 40 rupees in America, because I don't know how much that would be. That was nothing, actually. But just see how Prabhupada trusted in Krishna and his spiritual master and performed so many miracles, you know, and wind up having millions of dollars and thousands of children, devotees, you know, and so many temples with no money, starting with 40 rupees. And his work was to serve the Lord. When Srila Prabhupada was in Dwarka, the deities of Shishi, Radha, Dwarkadish, they were telling him to go back to India, but he didn't want to. He didn't want to go back. And Dwarkadish was telling him, no, you have to go. You have to go back. And Srila Prabhupada was saying, but this is such a nice temple, this is a beautiful temple, and Dwarkadish promised him, I'll give you a more beautiful temple than this temple, and we're all sitting in it. The desire of a pure devotee manifests. This organization manifested in his mind, and he even talked about, he would discuss it as if it was already established, before it was established. No. So the words of a pure devotee, particularly, you know, because he's so surrendered to the Lord, everything manifests because it's for the Lord, it's not for himself at all. Anything Srila Prabhupada got was given to the Lord. He never kept a farthing for himself. Everything was for the Lord. So this beautiful temple is the result, you know, of a pure devotee's desire and wish to bring all the conditioned souls to Krishna. And when I stand in the temple, I see all the people coming in, and I think, how happy Srila Prabhupada must be and how happy is Krishna to see all the different souls coming into the temple. Regardless of what the reason is, doesn't matter, but they're coming, you know? There's a few other points I wanted to talk about if I can get myself together here. This was something in here. One thing I also wanted to talk about was in the verse here, Prabhupada, this verse is interpreted as O maintainer of all living entities. So that's it's really Janardana, that's his name. So in this purport, and the reason that Arjuna is saying this because Janardana means the protector of all the living entities. So he was, according to, Srila Vidyabhusana, right? According to him, what it means is that Arjuna is saying to him, you're supposed to be protecting all the living entities. Why do you want me to do this? Why do you want me to do it? Arjuna wanted Krishna to do it. It's like, you do it. I don't want to do it. Actually, that was in his heart because he didn't want to incur all the sinful reactions. And he knew that Krishna, he's not going to get any sinful reactions because he's in control of everybody. You know, but Krishna wanted him to be the instruments, and that's where we all are. We're doing nothing on our own. Krishna is using us as an instrument. We should be very happy to be his instruments. So, I didn't cover everything, but because this is a very full purport. So as a natural devotee of the Lord, Arjuna did not like to retaliate against his miscreant cousins and brothers. And I also remember instances in the history of ISKCON, there are sometimes instances where Prabhupada, where the devotees were attacked, for instance, in New Vrindavan and other places when it was really very bad and seen as a cult, but Prabhupada told them to get a gun, defend, you know, the deities, defend the temple, defend the devotees, you know. We know about the Mataji who went to Nigeria, devotee Ladini, and she put herself in front of those soldiers who were going to kill the deities. Were going to kill the devotees. You know, so it's not that we just sit back and say, "Well, Krishna's going to take care." We should do our part, because whatever the outcome is going to be, it's always going to be up to Krishna. He's going to have his way anyway. So we should, you know, like, do the necessary. One devotee just, I talked with a couple of nights ago in the U.S., and one of my godbrothers, he's in the process of leaving his body, but they have put him in the hospital. He was talking and walking before he went into the hospital, but when he came out, first, they didn't want to let him out of the hospital. They had to get a lawyer to go and get the devotee out of the hospital because the people didn't want to let him go. You know, this is an example of, I have the power, especially a lot of times doctors think they can control life. I can give life, you know. They think they can control life. So they had to get a lawyer to threaten to sue the hospital if they didn't let my godbrother out. So now he's in the stages of hospice and preparing to leave his body. You know, but this is, you know, like, so the devotee asked me, well, what should we, before that, they didn't know what to do. And I was saying, well, do something. Whatever is going to happen is up to Krishna, but you have to do something. You have to do something. If you have a feeling that you should do something, then do it. And then whatever the outcome is, don't be attached to the results. Krishna will be there to take care of whatever is supposed to be done. It'll be his way. It's his way or the highway or the material way, you know, but it has to be his way. So we're all here surrendering or trying to surrender to Krishna, listening to, you know, his Krishna Katha, listening to Krishna Katha because we want to hear about Krishna and how he does things and how he wants us to do things. So I'll open it up for questions. I'm sorry I went over time. It's almost 10 after. Anyone have any questions if I can answer you? Yes,
Matiji. You said that something about emotions and something about sentiments. You said regards to the emotions and sentiments, like bhakti has to be scientific way, and we just cannot do things
whimsically.
Yeah, whimsically. So can you just highlight?
Well, you know, we do have emotions between devotees and between us and the Lord. These are transcendental. These are transcendental emotions because we're under the shelter of Krishna. But when we talk about sentiment, you know, we can't be sentimental. You know, it's not a sentimental process. We have a philosophy. We have to know the philosophy. If we're going to preach especially, we have to know the philosophy. You know, to... Okay, suppose someone asks you, why is there, you know, a battle going on in the beginning of the Gita? It's just politics. We have to know what to say to the person. We have to know it theoretically. We have to know what is said, what is going on. You know, we have to be able to tell them so they can understand. They should know this is not mundane. This is not ordinary. So we should be able to explain it. So, and in terms of feelings, you know, sometimes you feel one way, the next day you feel another way, and then the next day you feel one way, and then you feel this way. No, they're not permanent. They come in and go. It's just the waves of the material nature working through us. You know, so we should, you know, like try to keep a cool head. That's what Prabhupada said. Keep a cool head. Anything else? Is that okay? No?
And one more thing about the politician you're talking about. If you said something about politicians, they just want to do something for the power base. How do you actually rectify this? How do you rectify? I mean, if powers are being given to people who are at the top level and they are misusing it, how do you correct them?
Well, I'm trying to think of what Prabhupada had said in terms of politics. We don't have to get involved in the politics, material politics. You know, we don't have to. Even I know sometimes Prabhupada would encourage maybe if a devotee wanted to run for an office or something, you know. Or if you have God-conscious persons who are taking those kind of roles, like for instance, what's her name? Tulsi Gabbard. She's a devotee. She was running for office, you know? Then maybe that can make a difference. But in terms of the general mundane politics, it's just dog eat dog. That's what they do. The cheater and the cheated. So we shouldn't put any, like, of our energy into really worrying about what's happening between the politicians, because it'll happen, it was happening before we were born, it's gonna happen after we leave, because that's the way of the material world. It's just a fight. It's, Papa said, it's a nasty place.
And aggressors, you said something about aggressors to be taken.
Yes, it's in here, it says, those persons, it's in text 36 of the chapter we're in, the aggressors, the ones who are, you know, and because Krishna is there approving, Krishna is approving everything. He's there on the battlefield. So if it's led by Krishna, no problem. Krishna's leading.
He's given a stamp that these people have to be.
Yes. If you read chapter 11, the universal form in the Gita, read that. Read that one. No, the universal form. He shows what's happening. In that universal form, he's showing all those people on the battlefield are going into his mouth. He's already killed them. He's a controller. We all belong to him. And actually, anything he does is good. Anything. Everything. It's always good.
But we should read Mahabharata for reading Bhagavad Gita, because the things which are being kept in the Mahabharata is the initial part. So you said that you have to read the scriptures to decide to tell to others. So are we supposed to read Mahabharata before Bhagavad Gita?
No, you should just go ahead and read the Gita. Read those first. You can read the Mahabharata if you like. I like reading the Mahabharata. I liked it. But I also read, you know, the books that Srila Prabhupada put out, the Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam. He put out so many publications. All the answers are in his publications. He didn't leave anything out. So you should find one that resonates with you. All your questions will be answered by Srila Prabhupada. Okay? Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Thank you all so much for coming. You have one more? Yes, Prabhu.
Mataji asked actually regarding the politicians, how to rectify them. Correct? Actually, the ISKCON is dealing with the Krishna consciousness movement.
I'm sorry?
ISKCON. It is dealing with the Krishna consciousness movement. We are spreading the message of Krishna consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
This Krishna consciousness message bring the people to the right path.
Yes.
When it reaches to each every person, actually, you know, that every person will become right, actually, and then our problem will automatically solve.
Yes.
The politician will also be rectified.
Yes.
This is our main purpose.
Yes.
So in this way, the politician will be rectified.
Yes, we're giving our books. I think also during this time of the, you know, all the stuff that's going on about the diseases and everything's going, this is the best time when everybody's really, really disturbed to hand out the books. This is the best time. Big demonstrations going on in Canada too. Devotees should be there giving out books to all these people so they'll know which is the right path. You're right.
Yes.
When thank you.
When the message is reached to each and everybody, they will come to know
yes.
what is
yes.
wrong and what is good.
Yes. Hmm? Yes.
So at the moment, actually, people do not recognize what is good or what is bad, actually.
Right.
And they go after one another, actually. Hmm. They follow the mother, these bad rulers, actually.
Yes.
That's why they are not corrected.
And because they don't have the knowledge, they pick the wrong rulers. And then they get angry at that ruler and want to knock him out, but they chose him because they don't know who to pick.
Yes.
Right. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you all so much for coming. Happy Advaita Acharya Appearance Day. Jai. I hope everybody.